We got a lot of folks coming, that's why I'm waiting. You tired out, troops? Balance it out. Good afternoon. I am pleased to be joined by a number of my colleagues, some of whom will be speaking and others whom may answer questions. We had a vote today where we had an opportunity to act in a decisive way to protect the integrity of our voting system. The Republicans, to a person, I think it was unanimous on their side, rejected that opportunity. We are introducing a bill today to exercise responsibility for holding Russia accountable for its hostile actions against the United States of America. The Putin regime has consistently worked against the interests of the United States and our allies by attacking our democracy, which we had an opportunity to respond to today, and we failed, stealing Crimea and illegally occupying Georgia. We do not know whether our president confronted Mr. Putin on those two issues in the meeting they had. Supporting the murderous Assad regime in Syria, which we know that Russia has done blatantly, openly, and complicitly. Murdering its opponents. Attacking Western democracies and our critical NATO alliance. Today, my colleagues and I have introduced H.R. 6437, the Secure America for Russia Interference Act. This bipartisan, comprehensive legislation will do what President Trump has repeatedly failed to do. Hold Russia accountable, strengthen our election security, and bolster our alliances. This legislation brings together a number of bills, I think a list of which you have in your possession, many bipartisan, that are aimed at safeguarding our national security and protecting Americans' rights to cast their ballots and have their vote counted accurately. Congress must, it should, the American people expect us to adopt a bipartisan and unambiguous strategy to counter Russia's destabilizing activity. After President Trump's surprising and, yes, even shameful display in Helsinki, some Republicans have expressed concern, but press reports indicate they are throwing up their hands and saying there's nothing we can do. But there is something we can do. Bring this legislation to the fore and pass it with strong bipartisan support. Congress surely should do everything in its power to protect the American people. And this legislation is a step in the right direction. I want to thank all the members who worked hard on its provisions. Representative Engel, Representative Waters, Representative Swazi, Representative Carbajal, Representative Castro, Representative Connolly, Representative Correa, Representative Demings, Representative Heck, Representative Kennedy, Representative Kilmer, Representative Krishnamoorthy, Representative Moulton, and Representative Thompson. And I also want to thank my colleagues across the aisle, Representative Stefanik and Jones, for their support of this important legislation. I'm now pleased to yield to the ranking member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, Mr. Elliot Engel of New York. Elliot?
Thank you, Mr. Whip. Thank you, and thank my fellow members here as well. I'm Elliot Engel from New York, ranking member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, and I authored a part of this excellent bill that Mr. Hoyer has put together. We all know what a disgrace this week has been. The President's embarrassing performance, playing into the hands of our chief adversary, Vladimir Putin, sloppy damage control from the White House that at the end of the day just reaffirms what Mr. Trump said in Helsinki. And here on Capitol Hill, the phony protests of congressional Republicans who are throwing up their hands and complaining, we've done so much already, what else can we do? The idea that Congress has exhausted all its options to rein in the administration and push back on Russia is just preposterous. Relative to the size of the threat we're facing, Congress has done next to nothing. It's like saying, a hurricane just smashed the coast and another is on the way. Let's send a few rolls of paper towels. So the next time we hear the question, what more can Congress do? Here's the answer. This piece of legislation right here. Right here. Here's the answer. The one we all put together under Mr. Hoyer's leadership. The part I wrote, along with Jerry Connolly of Virginia, would ratchet up sanctions. Unlike the sanction package we passed last year, this measure specifically goes after anyone who interferes with the American elections from overseas, or anyone who interfered in the past. And the past is important because we have a good deal of knowledge that the Russians did intercede. This is especially important that we look back in light of Special Counsel Mueller's most recent indictments of 12 Russian intelligence officers. We're learning more and more about just how damaging Russia's attack was, about the tactics they used to support Donald Trump, Putin's preferred candidate, as he himself admitted. We cannot let those responsible off the hook. That's what we're attempting to do today. All of us standing up here have been pushing the administration since day one to take this threat seriously, to protect our democracy. But I don't think the stakes have been clearer than they are this week. The President made it clear that he's taking Putin's side over our American intelligence community. What a shame, what a disgrace. Over law enforcement, over our friends and allies around the world. It's unbelievable that we would stand here and say that about an American president. But we all saw it with our own eyes. It's not political spin or political hype. We saw what the president did. He sided with Putin over American intelligence. He sided with Russia over the United States. That means to meet this challenge, it needs to start right here in the Congress. As long as President Trump abdicates his responsibility to defend the United States, it's up to us. We won't stand by when the president is acting as Putin's poodle. There's more we can do and must do. This bill will put us on that path. So I thank you, and I'm happy to introduce my friend from California, the ranking member of the Financial Services Committee, Maxine Waters.
Thank you. Thank you, Ranking Member Engel. But let me just say a special word of thanks to Steny Hoyer. This is long overdue. The American people are expecting us to resist some of the policies and initiatives and actions that this president has shown to the American people. And the way that he's defined himself, we really need to take time to address the issues. And so it is absolutely essential that Congress take strong action to counter the malign activities of Russia and Putin, protect our democracy from their harmful actions, and move swiftly to pass this critical package of bills, the Secure America from Russia Interference Act. Back in April of 2017, I introduced the No Russia Exemptions for Oil Production Act. The bill prevents the Trump administration from circumventing Russia sanctions that banned oil deals in the Russian Arctic Shelf, the Black Sea, and Siberia by restricting the export of technology that Russia would need in order to be able to drill for oil in these areas. Under current law, the president can provide waivers or special licenses to companies to engage in activities related to oil exploitation and drilling in Russia. It is clear that the president should not have this authority, so my bill would revoke his discretion to provide these waivers. It has never been more apparent that Putin has something over this president. My bill is one step to stop the pro-Russia actions of this president, who just this week put on a shameful display of bowing down to Putin to the detriment of the United States. To that end, I'm pleased that my bill is included in this important package of legislation that we are introducing today to hold Russia accountable and safeguard our country. So I thank you. Next, we will hear from Congressman Nadler, the ranking member of the Judiciary Committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Maxine. I want to begin by thanking our distinguished Democratic Whip, Mr. Hoyer, for bringing us together today and for bringing this legislation today, for amalgamating many different bills the Democratic members have put together to form a comprehensive response to the Russian aggression against our democratic system. From one day to the next, President Trump does not seem to know where he stands on the issue of Russian interference in our elections. But the American people know where they stand when a foreign power attacks our democracy. And this bill presents a clear and unambiguous strategy for countering Russian aggression in the United States and abroad. On July 10, 2001, the Phoenix Field Office of the FBI forwarded a memorandum to headquarters to advise the Bureau of an effort by Osama bin Laden to send associates to the United States to enroll in civil aviation courses. For a host of complicated reasons, the Bush administration did not follow up adequately, and 2 months later, on September 11th, in my district, tragically, the World Trade Center attacked and fell. Last Friday, Special Counsel Robert Mueller indicted 12 Russian nationals for hacking into the Democratic National Committee, the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, and several state election systems. This indictment is a remarkable piece of forensic work. With the aid of the intelligence community, the special counsel can name the specific Russian military intelligence officers at the keyboard on a given day. This latest indictment can surely be seen as the equivalent of the warning signs prior to 9/11. In the words of Dan Coats, a distinguished former Republican senator and President Trump's hand-picked director of national intelligence, our digital infrastructure is literally under attack by the Russian government as we speak. These indictments are a warning, and we must heed the warning. In Helsinki, President Trump said he does not believe it. He sided with Vladimir Putin over his own intelligence community. Then he reversed course and said he just misspoke, thinking the American people would buy his manipulated story over what we all witnessed for ourselves. And yesterday, he again contradicted his director of national intelligence. When asked whether Russia was still targeting the United States, the president answered, no. President Trump's continued state of denial undermines American law enforcement, proclaiming on the world stage that our laws are meaningless, that the work of investigators has been worthless, and that no one should take the special counsel seriously. That is a catastrophe in the making. If we do not take any action, the American people may not trust the outcome of the next election. Our Republican colleagues have chosen to hide their heads in the sand. They want us to endlessly investigate Hillary Clinton's emails and vote on meaningless resolutions that they think will make a nice press release. But we intend to act. I am proud to stand with my colleagues today, and I hope the Republican leadership will stand with us too. They should stand up to the president and stand up for America and pass this legislation to protect the integrity of our elections so that we can be confident in our elections and to stand up to the Russians and tell them you cannot attack the United States without paying a very, very high price. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nano. Thank you, Mr. Engel. And thank you, Ms. Waters. As you will note from the list of bills that are included within this comprehensive piece of legislation, although I mentioned two Republicans who are co-sponsors, you will note that many of the bills that are incorporated in this legislation are supported by Republicans, are co-sponsored by Republicans as well. We believe this should be a bipartisan effort. The confronting an enemy that tries to undermine our democracy, our elections, our integrity in our newscasting is an enemy that needs to be confronted in a bipartisan way. This is not about Republicans or Democrats. This is about America. This is about our country. This is about our security. And hopefully we can join together working on this legislation. Mr. Cohen was up here, but Mr. Cohen has a significant piece of this legislation. So I thank all of you for being here, and we'll open it up for questions.
Mr. Cohen.
Chad.
Thank you. I saw most of the colloquy between you and Mr. McCarthy, and it doesn't seem like there's any plan to put this on the schedule before the end of the month.
Well, we just introduced it today.
Well, right, I understand, but that gets us to September. And there's not enough time to do that now. I mean, a lot of people would say, even if you're talking about this in the middle of July, the horse is out of the barn to be able to do anything structurally that would make a difference, protect the integrity of the election.
Well, on the election, I think we could move pretty quickly. We could move next week. I was very disappointed, as you heard me say in the colloquy, that the Republicans to a person rejected, and the Democrats to a person supported, rejected an opportunity which would not have any effect on the bill. Mr. Frelinghuysen, the chairman of the committee, in speaking in opposition to the amendment, didn't mention the amendment. He said it was a good bill. It was a good bill, which this amendment, Mr. Quigley's amendment, would have had no adverse effect whatsoever. What it would have done is strengthen the ability of the United States of America and our election officials throughout this country to secure our voting apparatus. And I would hope we could at least do that, as I said in the colloquy today. Yeah.
How many committees did the component measures of this package come from, if somebody says that it didn't go through regular order?
Well, of course, regular order is not always followed, as you know, but I think my trusty senior policy advisor is saying six.
I have a question. Was President Trump right to push our NATO allies to pay more for their own defense?
Look, I think it has been a consistent position of Democratic and Republican administrations and an agreement within NATO itself that there would be a 2% target. I think the president was reiterating our support for that target and urging our European allies to achieve that target. Having said so, no previous president has been so confrontational as opposed to cooperative with our close allies and friends. In my opinion, while he was appropriate in urging the objective, he was inappropriate in the way he did it.
Yes. Have there been any briefings from the administration, either formal or informal, about what unfolded at the Helsinki summit, and would you like to hear?
Well, let me yield to Mr. Engel, none that I have participated in. Let me yield to Mr. Engel, who's on the Foreign Affairs Committee, ranking member of the Foreign Affairs Committee.
Well, the answer would be no. I mean, I would hope at some point the answer would be yes, but the fact is we really don't know. And the president, of course, has contradicted himself so many times that you don't even know if he knows what he knows. I mean, it's just absolutely ridiculous. He meant to say this, he didn't really mean that, and the next day he goes back to what he originally said. So I cannot think in the history of our country, with all the presidents we've had, that we have had a president who has been so belligerent towards our allies. What the president's done, he's hurt the NATO alliance, he's hurt the European Union. He made fun of Macedonia. The United States wouldn't part of the important principles of NATO is that an attack on one country is an attack on all countries. And the president said, well, the United States wouldn't necessarily go to war over Macedonia, singled out Macedonia. It's really just not the way anybody should act, let alone the leader of the free world. So Congress is the last person they consult with when they make a move or when they make a declaration. But to tell you the truth, I don't think the president consulted with his own people. I just think that he shoots from the hip, whatever is in his mind comes out, and I'll bet his own people, when they see it come out and he starts ad-libbing, they think, oh, my God, what's he going to say now? I cannot tell you. I've been in this Congress 30 years. I cannot tell you another time, because there is no other time, where any president of the United States had such a sorry and poor performance and appearance on the world stage.
Yeah. Let me just add, you may have noticed that the Russians have announced that they are going to begin implementing the agreements that were reached between President Trump and President Putin. Now, we have no idea of what agreements, if any, were reached, but the Russians have announced that they're going to begin implementing the agreements. It's unconscionable, if agreements were reached, that we don't know what they are, that the president doesn't tell us what they are. It is unprecedented for an American president to meet with a foreign leader without someone else present, without other Americans present, other than the interpreter. But to hear from the Russians now that there are agreements reached, and they won't tell us what those agreements were, is beyond imagination.
Last question.
Just let me, in finishing that question, say that domestically, here in the Congress, with the administration, almost invariably, you have other people in the room on both sides when they're having a discussion about things of importance. Not because of any wrongdoing per se, but because there is a necessity to make sure that you get it right. That there is, in fact, a meeting of the minds, not a talking past one another. We don't know. The administration, Secretary of State doesn't know. The National Security Advisor doesn't know. They only know what Trump told them. And frankly, we have seen a demonstration over the last years of the accuracy of the president's representations of facts. Last question.
I have a question for Congresswoman Waters. You put out a statement last night about this group, the Oath Keepers, that are going to be demonstrating in your district, armed protesters or something. Just wonder if you can talk to that. And also, I've been at a couple campaign rallies with the president the last 30 days or so, where he's called you the new face of the Democratic Party. And I'm wondering what that's meant to you, if you welcome that label, if you wear it as a pride of honor, or a badge of honor, or what you think about it.
Well, first of all, allow me to tell you that I just came from the floor. And I came from the floor to talk about the children who are still separated from their parents. And I've decided, in the way that I handle my issues, I'm not going to allow this president to divert me from the issues that I think are so important to the American people. And so right now, the separation of children from their parents, and some of these parents that may have been deported, it's first thing on my mind. Secondly, let me just say this. I think the president has defined himself very well. From the time he was in the campaign in the primary, up through the time that he has served. We all know who he is, what he's all about, what he stands for, and the kind of diversions that he's doing. So I'm not concerned about all of that extraneous stuff. I'm concerned about our efforts here in Congress to come up with the kind of legislation that you see in this package to address the problems that has been created by this administration. And so I don't know, and I don't keep up with everything that he's saying. I know where I am on this issue. I've made myself very clear for months, and I've talked about the fact that I do believe that we should pay more attention to this president and his allies, his relationship to Putin, his relationship to Deutsche Bank, and perhaps what I think may have be money laundering issues. Also, I want us to pay attention to the sanctions that I think Putin and this president would like to see lifted so that they can drill for oil and they can be involved in creating the kind of money and dollars and profits that I think they're all interested in. And I continue to say, follow the money. And if the American people will continue to watch this president in the way that he conducts himself, the way that he does not tell the truth, I think eventually we will be able to turn the tide on what has been happening in this administration for far too long. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
On the Oath Keepers, though, ma'am, the demonstrators in your district, do you have any comment on that? You put out a statement, a lengthy statement on that last time. Just wondering why you don't comment on that. I got the written statement. Yeah, I was just wondering.
Okay, comment on the statement, please.
That's my response. That's my statement.
I have a question.
Corn cob?